Namaskar and welcome to In Focus. Last week saw the presentation in Parliament of the first BJP and the first post-Pokhran budget. Today, the Finance Minister Yashwant Sinha talks about his budget and responds to the many comments made about it. Mr. Sinha, later on I want to talk about some of the detailed aspects of your budget, but let's begin by talking about the big broad picture you've painted. How do you respond to comments made that in trying to be all things to all people, your budget lacks, or people have said, is a clear, focused vision and direction?
I don't accept this point of view. First of all, I would like to say that I have not tried to be all things to all people. There is a very clear focus in this budget, to my mind. And that focus is rooted in the reality of today. And it takes into account the reality of Indian economics, the Indian situation. I have talked about things which are of great importance to India, and I have tried to cater to the needs of that segment, you see, while not neglecting the others. But the emphasis is very clear. The emphasis is on agriculture. The emphasis is on rural development. The emphasis is on a smaller scale industry. The emphasis is on PSU reform.
Let me put you...
The emphasis is on NRIs.
Let me put you some of the comments that people have made which will explain why I made this opening question. Some people have said that in part your budget is protectionist. Some people have said that in part, in fact, it's reformist. Others say that in part it encourages foreign investment. And yet the comment is also made that in part because it doesn't talk too much about exports and sanctions, it ignores the outside world. The picture that's emerging is of a tightrope walk, a balancing act.
No, that's a picture which is emerging from the kind of reports that you might have seen in a variety of the media that we are confronted with today. Each one has interpreted the message of the budget in his own light. Therefore, you will have a wide spectrum of comment, starting from very good, excellent, to bogus.
But doesn't this worry you that, with the exception perhaps of the industrialists who are the direct beneficiaries of the 8% import tax that you brought in, almost all other comments from the stock market, from newspaper columnists, from exporters, is a comment that fails to recognize central vision. They all say it lacks direction, it lacks thrust.
Because what are the people you are talking about? You are talking about the stock market, you are talking about perhaps the FIIs, you are talking about the foreign investor, you are talking about the, I don't know who else. They have no interest in rural India. They have no interest. And therefore, any emphasis on rural India will be completely missed by them, because they will not see it.
Are you saying that the vision and the thrust is one for rural India?
It is. It is very clearly. It is very clearly a major thrust for rural India. It's a major thrust for development. It's a major thrust for kick-starting the economy, as I had.
Would you say that this is the first budget in modern times that has rural India at the center of its lens?
It's a first budget in many years, and certainly the first budget of the reform era, which has gone out of its way to recognize the fact that rural India, that Indian agriculture, is central to Indian economy.
And yes, you've done this deliberately?
I have done this deliberately because this is part of our policy.
And this is something that when critics say the budget lacks vision, your reply is it only lacks vision to those who don't think rural India is central and important.
Absolutely. If they think that only a few metropolitan cities matter in this country, if they think that a handful of the interests that they represent matter in this country, then I'm sorry, this is not true.
Okay.
Because 60-70% of our people live in rural areas, and they must be cared. And it's good economic sense. It is not obscurantism of any kind. It is good economic sense.
Okay, let's see whether it is good economic sense in a moment's time. But your answer to those who comment that the budget lacks vision and direction is to say, the vision is rural India, the direction is in the direction of rural India. Only those who don't think rural India is central make this sort of comment.
That's right.
Okay. The other major criticism made of your budget is that you failed to acknowledge, you failed to respond to, you failed to give confidence to people who are worried about two major problems that they think the economy faces at the moment. Let's take one of them first, exports. It said that our export growth is down to 2.6, having been just 3 years ago 20%, 21%, 22%. And your budget doesn't give any reassurance, it doesn't instill any confidence that you've actually handled this.
You see, this budget is being presented almost in the middle of the year. A few weeks before the budget, my colleague, the Commerce Minister, had come out with an export-import policy. The instrument for promoting exports is the export-import policy. And if it had preceded the budget, you would have noticed that there are a lot of ideas, there are a lot of initiatives for promoting India's exports in that export-import policy. Now, once the requirement of export had been taken care of in that export-import policy, a few weeks later, I didn't really have to re-emphasize that.
No, but do you not think that you could have once again said in the budget that we've already taken measures in the EXIM policy, we are aware of the problem?
I read that budget speech for 2 hours. If I had another 2 hours, maybe I would have said all these things.
But does it not worry you that a very large section of exporters feel that on the day when they wanted to hear your concern and they wanted to hear you give them confidence, you neither sounded concerned nor did you give them confidence. In fact, you left them feeling neglected.
No, I don't think so. I don't think it's true. That's not my impression.
Okay, let me put to you the sort of comments they make. They say that at the moment we're losing markets to Southeast Asian countries almost every single day, and this is going to get worse as Southeast Asian banks recover and their currencies stay cheap. Yet not only has Mr. Yashwant Sinha not acknowledged this predicament, he's actually gone and imposed an 8% tax that makes several exporters hurt.
The exporters will not be hurt, you see, because the exporters will get back most of it by way of other concessions which are available to them. And as far as the Asian currencies are concerned, depreciation of the Asian currencies, it didn't happen yesterday. It has been there for the last 16 months.
The sort of exporter who will hurt is, for instance, automobile component parts exporters, engineering goods exporters. The duty that now makes their access to steel more expensive is one that's going to make their product more expensive and therefore less competitive.
You see, when you are preparing a budget of a country like India, you are faced with constituencies whose interests are at loggerheads with each other. And there is no way in which you can satisfy them all. The steel industry in India is down in the dumps. And if for some other consumers I were to destroy the steel industry in India, then to my mind it will be a very wrong policy to follow. So the steel industry was in need of some succor.
Your eyes, helping the steel industry was the greater priority, and if the problem resulted in one or two exporters suffering, well, they have to live with it.
Well, you see, we have tried to help coal. Now, if you try to help coal, you hurt the steel industry. It's all linked. Now, the steel makers are crying that, you know, coking coal imports will carry 8% CVD. Now, somewhere or the other, one has to draw a line and say, all right, you live with this.
You see, you sound so reasonable when you explain it today to me. Why could you not in your budget have just simply said to the export community that you're aware of the problem they face?
I think
you're aware
of their need. Even in this interview on exports, I mean, there are other areas which should be of interest.
I want to come to those, but it's just that here's a community who's really suffering, and they say he wasn't aware of it.
Do you know, Mr. Karan Thapar, that I have given up a revenue of 3,500 crore in trying to give in that export-import policy concessions to the Indian exporter? He can now the threshold for import of capital goods for exporters.
Perhaps if you'd made just that point in your budget speech, they would have realized that you've already done things for them.
So this point is already made. Any well-informed exporter knows it. I don't know which exporter you are talking about.
Okay, let's come to a second point, an area where people think that perhaps you weren't responsive to the problem they fear is going to happen. Many people are worried that the threat of sanctions is going to affect the economy. And they say that at a moment when they wanted reassurance, they wanted the instilling of confidence, the finance minister ignored the subject.
I did not ignore the subject. I said clearly in the beginning of my speech that some of the countries abroad have responded negatively as far as India's nuclear tests are concerned. And I said, with the passage of time, I hope they will understand our position better as far as the steps taken by them is concerned. It will not have any significant impact on India's economic development. And that's a statement.
But do you really believe it won't have a significant impact in 98, 99?
No, absolutely not.
Sanctions will not have a significant impact.
Absolutely not.
Okay, let me put to you what Dr. Manmohan
Singh said. Let me explain this a little further. You see, the only country in the world which has imposed sanctions in India, on India, under its law, is the USA. No other country has imposed sanctions.
Quite right, but the World Bank has begun to postpone consideration of
loans. All right, I'll come to that. You see, now under the Glenn Amendment, which the US has, US is obliged by that law to impose sanctions. Now, what does the Glenn Amendment say? Glenn Amendment says that US banks shall not lend to the government of the country on which sanctions have been imposed. Now, government of India has not borrowed, is not in the market for borrowing money from the American banks.
So the government of India is not affected by the sanctions?
Government of India is not affected
by the sanctions. So the finance minister won't say anything about the subject?
No, don't jump the gun. Number two, the Americans have not yet defined the depth of the sanctions. The spread of the sanction, what exactly will the sanctions mean, has not yet been defined by the USA. Number three, that other countries, including the World Bank, which is a multilateral agency, they have deferred the debts. Nobody has, or the loans, nobody has said that projects which have already been approved, they'll also be starved of funds. Now, this position has to be understood very clearly.
I do.
Now, you see, anything which is being deferred at this point of time will impact on the budget something like in 12 to 18 months' time.
Quite right. But
how do I factor that in the budget
today? The logic of what you're saying is irrefutable. I concede that. Nonetheless, you have a constituency that's concerned and understandably concerned. You're a finance minister at budget time who's supposed to be giving confidence and reassurance.
Let me finish.
Your famous predecessor, Dr. Manmohan Singh, said in one of his interviews after the budget, perhaps you should have created a deliberate cushion so that people were aware and reassured that if things happen that shouldn't, there's already some provision made. Just that reassurance would have been sufficient. You didn't do it.
When I said that it will not have any significant impact on India's economic development, that was the reassurance that I was trying to convey. Now, if Mr. Manmohan Singh has not been able to be reassured, I'll try and reassure him in Parliament.
Let me add a further comment that he made. He said, and I quote, that sanctions could affect the flow of capital into India, both portfolio and direct. He said it could affect balance of payments. He says it can affect the exchange rate. And he says it may even affect the interest rate. Is he wrong?
It could even lead to war. Now, would somebody say that I have not factored in a war in this budget?
No.
But what is
Let's
it?
Not go I to mean, the extreme
no,
example
no.
of war.
These are extreme examples.
No, couldn't you have sketched out
no,
in your budget
no,
what
no,
some
no,
people
I,
call the I, best case
this,
and worst
this
case
This is what
scenario?
I'm saying, that if it is the budget speech is not the time to clarify everything. In the budget speech, you talk in sutra. You make your point not in so many words. You indicate it in a few words, and that's exactly what...
If you talk in sutra and people don't think you've delivered the message, then are you not talking too much in brief?
No. There's a whole range of explanation that we will be offering in Parliament, outside. This is the opportunity where I'm offering that explanation.
Okay, let me put it like this. In view of the comments you've heard many times about the fact that you ignored exports, and in view of the comment that people think you've ducked the sanctions issue, do you think now with hindsight, if you were rewriting the budget speech, you would have put in some reassurance?
I wouldn't change it. Not a word.
You wouldn't add a word?
Absolutely.
Then how do you answer a comment again from someone like Professor Meghna Desai and also from Dr. Manmohan Singh, who say that because he hasn't talked
about
these subjects...
Because they don't understand. Because they don't understand the implications of the sanctions.
So Dr. Manmohan Singh is in fact talking out of turn and talking too quickly.
He's anticipating too many things at this point of time.
He's in fact scaring people when they don't need to be scared.
I personally feel that there is no need to create panic on account of sanctions.
And people like him are creating panic.
I am not saying that. But I am saying that generally there is no need to create panic in regard to sanctions. If sanctions are defined, imposed on India as and when, then we'll stand up and take the country into confidence.
I'll accept
But
that.
I can't dream about sanctions. I can't imagine and then factor that
Which
in,
is why you couldn't
budget.
Have sketched out worst case and best case scenarios.
Quite not. I mean, you don't do that. Nobody has ever done that in the budget. You don't say this is the budget for the best case scenario, this is the budget for the worst case scenario.
Okay.
Have you ever seen anybody do that?
Let me then leave this by asking the last question on this particular matter. Both Dr. Manmohan Singh and Professor Meghnath Desai have said that this is essentially an interim budget. He's going to be forced
they're
to come up...
They're absolutely wrong. That's what I'd like to say. I mean, Dr. Manmohan Singh, I can understand, is not talking as an economist. He's talking as a politician. He's the leader of opposition in the Rajya Sabha. It is his dharma to criticize this budget, and this is what he's doing.
On that note, we'll take a commercial break. I want to come back in part two and talk about some of the very innovative and courageous reform measures, because I'll grant you that the budget has those, because I think it's important to concentrate on that. But first, we'll take a quick commercial break. See you in a moment. Welcome back. We're talking to Finance Minister Yashwant Sinha. Mr. Sinha, I want in this part to talk about some of the innovative reform measures that you've introduced. And let's start with the opening of the insurance sector. Why have you kept out foreign insurance companies?
Well, that's our policy.
Well, if your intention was to break the monopoly of GIC and LIC, which is what you said is, if your intention is to increase choice, and if your intention is to reduce the price the consumer has to pay for a service, then do you seriously believe that inexperienced small Indian companies can take on giants like LIC and GIC?
Not inexperienced small Indian companies, but big Indian companies would be able to give that kind of service to the consumer.
But where are the big Indian companies? They have
well,
to grow.
Well, let's see. You see, what there's a philosophy behind this. And what is that philosophy? The philosophy is you create competition. You want to end a monopoly in certain sector, whether it's a private sector monopoly or a public sector monopoly. Now, you create competition in two stages, maybe. You create competition first by opening it to the domestic sector. Then you create competition when we have acquired some strength. Then you expose it to external competition.
But if the domestic sector on its own can't provide the competition...
We'll see. How do we judge at this point of time? You see, this is this, what I have said in the budget speech is that we will expose it to competition. We will open it to the Indian private sector. I have also said that this will take some time. I'll be able to bring a legislation in this regard later this year, which means the winter session of Parliament. Now, in the meanwhile, there'll be discussion. In the meanwhile, with this announcement, Indian companies will be gearing up. When we actually open up, when we get that legislation passed through Parliament, then that will be the time, appropriate time, to be discussing this.
All right. Let me ask you a critical question. You've said that you're restricting the opening up to Indian companies. Under the Companies Act, any company registered in India as an Indian company, is that your definition of an Indian company?
There are companies and companies, you're quite right. But in every sector, the amount of foreign shareholding is defined.
Are you prepared to accept a minority foreign shareholding?
I am not in a position to answer that question as yet.
But you're not ruling it out?
I am saying what I have said in the budget speech. I've chosen my words very carefully, and I stick to them that we will open it to Indian insurance companies, Indian private sector companies.
But you've said two very important things. First of all, you said that you very possibly could accept the Indian Company Act definition of an Indian company.
No, you told me that the Indian Companies Act has this definition.
And you said that there are companies and companies. But you didn't say I'm not accepting the Indian Companies Act definition.
No, how can I? That's the law of the land.
And that law of the land...
I can't say, but if you have...
law of the land requires
what
you to
applies,
accept the Indian Company
no, but
Act's
what,
definition.
Yeah, but we don't go by Indian Companies Act definition in every case. What is good for, let's say, the oil sector may not be good for the banking sector.
Let me ask a simple question. You're not ruling out the possibility that when you take this decision...
I'm not accepting it either.
No, but you're not ruling it out.
I'm not accepting it. I'm not going beyond what I have said already. Indian private sector.
Let me then put one corollary. Many people will read between the lines of what you said and assume, as I'm assuming, he's not ruling it out.
He can't say more
because that would be embarrassing. But the corollary is also a very strange one. They're saying he's just announced a major innovation, and yet when he's asked for one of the most critical details, he says, I don't know.
No, I'm not saying I don't know.
I won't tell?
No, I'm saying it is Indian private companies which will be allowed in the insurance sector. Now, if you are telling me that suppose an Indian private sector company is not able to deliver the goods.
No. I'm saying something else now. Indian private companies, as defined by the Companies Act, includes companies with minority foreign shareholding.
But this is what I'm saying. No, but this is what I'm saying. That Companies Act also provides for 100% Indian companies. mean, Companies Act never says...
You haven't as yet said clearly whether you're going to only permit one of those or both of those or none.
No, I am
you're
saying
leaving it open.
You are talking about the Companies Act. I didn't start the Companies Act.
But why can't you be upfront and say
no,
it to
I
me
don't,
clearly?
Because I want to learn from experience.
So the possibility is left open?
No, you are saying that Indian companies, and many other people are saying, Indian companies will not be able to deliver the goods. I am saying we will see when we finally open the insurance sector.
When will that
Indian,
be? When will that
I,
be?
I have said in the budget speech that I will bring legislation in this regard later this year. Now, later this year means the winter session of Parliament.
And then it will all
then
be clear
we will
whether
have the,
minority shareholdings are permitted
will,
or not.
No, let me tell you. Then we will have the insurance regulatory authority in the picture. It will be the job of the insurance regulatory authority to call for applications from the Indian private sector and then see what happens. I mean, why should we
so
start...
So the IRA will determine what sort of company is permitted?
IRA will determine what kind of companies will do business in the insurance sector.
So the decision whether a company that does business
no, I think
can have a foreign
no,
minority
you,
shareholding
you,
will be determined
you wanting
that
to state. Corner me.
I'm
and
not
I don't want, yes.
I just
I don't want,
tell
no,
me.
No, no. I would plead with you not to draw any wrong conclusions here.
I'm not drawing any wrong conclusions. I leave it to the audience to draw the conclusion.
No, don't even leave
it
to the audience.
I'll move on.
I am saying, once again, repeating very clearly, I am standing by what I said in the budget speech.
All
Indian
right.
private companies.
I'll leave it there because I think the smile suggests something else, but let's
all
not
right.
follow. Let me raise something else very quickly. You have also said that your intention is to divest up to 76% shareholding in non-strategic public sector 74 in non-strategic
yeah.
public sector units, but you haven't said when you're going to do this and start.
How can I say when I'm going to do? You see, I have said 2-3 things about the public sector. I have said in one part of my speech that government is going to disinvest certain amounts of shares of 4 undertakings: Concor, GAIL,
right.
BSNL, IOC.
And you then made a general commitment to divest 74% in non-strategic ones.
This is one part.
But you set no time frame for
no,
that.
No, I can't set a time frame because when you are disinvesting, it depends on how the market is behaving, what price you are likely to get.
Okay, you haven't
I am not going to sell my shares at any point of time, at any price.
You haven't even set a starting date for beginning that.
There's no need for me to define that. It's absolutely wrong to think that I should have defined the date. Because we already have these four companies in the pipeline.
Well, let me tell you why people want you to define the date. Because they say in the absence of defining a starting date and in the absence of taking any measure that the stock market would have wanted to revive the capital market, he actually doesn't mean this seriously.
No,
this is
no.
just an intention, nothing
no,
more.
No, it's absolutely wrong. But I'll also tell you that budgets are not made with a stock market in mind. No finance minister worth his salt will make a budget for the stock market.
Okay, budgets are obviously made with politicians in the country in
no,
mind.
No, the budgets are made with the people of the country in mind.
Dr. Manmohan Singh has said that this clearly is not a serious intention of the government because he's actually only budgeted 5,000 crore in the budget.
Yeah, but why didn't he say it? I mean, why didn't he do it in his budgets? Or why didn't Chidambaram say it in his budgets if it was only a question of saying it? Even saying calls for courage.
And you think that at the moment your
they
critics are not
the courage.
And you think at the moment your critics are not acknowledging your courage?
Absolutely.
They're being churlish.
Well, they are in politics.
Are you hurt by this failure?
I'm not. I when a politician criticizes something, I take it that he is doing his dharma.
My last question. Your budget is suddenly run smack bang into a lot of political opposition in Parliament. Are you confident that the things that you cherish will be passed without amendment?
Absolutely confident.
You're already being forced to have to halve the urea. Your allies in Parliament are probably going to force you to halve the rest of the urea increase. Are you worried that they won't play around with public sector disinvestment
no.
or insurance?
No, I am not worried.
You're absolutely confident?
Absolutely.
On that note, Mr. Yashwant Sinha, thank you very much for talking to us and thank you very much for responding to what your critics have been commenting about your budget. That's it for this week. We'll be back next week with another interviewee. But for today, from the Finance Minister's office in North Block, New Delhi, goodbye.